Good to see everybody with us this morning. Thank you so much for being here as we praise and worship our God together. It is it's interesting to me in speaking to my preaching brethren to see what their plan is and kind of how they feel and how they view the last Sunday morning sermon before Christmas, to see what they have to think about and what they have to say about it. And there are many who will point out that God never says anywhere in Scripture that December 25th was the birth of Christ. And God never tells us anywhere in Scripture to worship, or rather to celebrate the birth of Jesus Christ. And that is absolutely true. And so some will kind of shy away on this particular sermon from talking about Christ at all in an effort not to leave a false impression. And if whatever they preach on is the truth, then the truth was taught. And that's something to be happy about. And there are others who kind of take a different view that, you know, if we have visitors on this day, particularly ones who don't often come, well, they're probably coming because on this day they're thinking about Christ and they don't think a lot about Him maybe at other parts in the year. So I want to go ahead and preach on Christ on this service because folks tend to be thinking about Him at this time. And if what they teach on Christ is the truth, that is a good thing and something to celebrate and to be happy about. I am of the opinion that there is no such thing as an inappropriate time to talk about Jesus Christ. But I don't want to talk to you this morning about that baby lying in the manger, though I am extraordinarily grateful to God that it happened. I want to talk to you this morning about the man that baby grew into. I'm grateful for Ron for leading that song, "Oh, How I Love Jesus," before the sermon this morning. I requested that and he did a fine job with it. So thank you, Ron. What I want to do in the sermon this morning, and this cannot at all be a comprehensive list, so I don't want you to think that it is. I just want to talk to you this morning about some of the reasons that I love Jesus. I hope there are things that you consider in your own life. And perhaps you'll hear some things that you hadn't thought about and will increase your own appreciation, your own love. But let's jump right into it. And I want to start here. I love Jesus because He shows us the holiness of God. The introduction to John's Gospel is one of the most well-known passages in all of Scripture. I want us to consider just a small portion of it. In the first three verses, as well as verse 14, this is what John says. "In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God, and the Word was God. He was in the beginning with God. All things were made through Him, and without Him was not anything made that was made." Move down to verse 14. "And the Word became flesh and dwelt among us, and we have seen His glory, glory as of the only Son from the Father, full of grace and truth." Now there are passages in Scripture that we can look at the truth of them, we can marvel at the truth of them, but if we ever try to explain how the process worked or how it happened and God accomplished it, we're never going to get there. God Himself didn't feel the need to explain how all of this works. And I think that's because of our limited understanding, and he knows we're simply not going to be able to grasp it. But what a truth, isn't it? What a truth this is. Now, I think you know as well as I do the instruction, the commands, the direction that we find in Scripture. It all is designed by God to lead us to holiness. And we're thankful for it. We're happy for it. And the trust really comes in, and even in those places when we may not be able to understand the command and why God chose to do it, we trust God. And we recognize that if He said it, He has a goal, He has an aim in mind, and that's to make us more and more like Him. And He said, "Be holy, for I am holy." And so when we see the instruction and the guidance and the commands, we can be glad of those things because we know where they lead. It's a really interesting statement made by Moses over in Deuteronomy 6. And I tell you what, if it's been a while since you've read this chapter, take the time to do it. It teaches us so much about God. But this is what Moses says at the end of this chapter. "And the Lord commanded us to do all these statutes, to fear the Lord our God for our good always, that He might preserve us alive as we are this day. And it will be righteousness for us if we are careful to do all this commandment before the Lord our God as He commanded us." If we do what God commands, and this is just as true under the new covenant as it was under the old, if we do all that God commands, it will be righteousness for us. And it will lead us in a way of holiness and in a way that pleases God. So when we're doing it the way we should, we ought to feel like the psalmist in Psalm 119. We just delight in the law of the Lord because it comes from Him. And there is extraordinary benefit in it. But I want to tell you this, and I want you to think about this. While commands, direction, instruction is beneficial, is important, there is nothing more helpful than watching God in the flesh not just tell us, but show us how to do it. And that's what happened when Jesus came here. That's what happened. In John chapter 14, verses 8 and 9, it was a tough time for the disciples. I mean, let's not imagine it was an easy time for the Lord. He's very quickly approaching the cross, but it seems to have finally gotten through to them. He is going to die. He keeps talking about it, and that time is here. And in the midst of those final few chapters where Jesus is having this private discussion, this kind of last minute instruction before all of those events, Philip makes a statement. Over in verses 8 and 9, Philip said to him, "Lord, show us the Father, and it is enough for us. If you'll just do it, just open a quick window. Just let us look up and see the Father. If you'll just do that, we're good. Everything will be fine." And then Jesus made that incredible statement to him. "Have I been with you so long, Philip, and you still do not know me? Whoever has seen me has seen the Father. How can you say, 'Show us the Father'?" So I want to say this again. When Jesus was on this earth, we're not just looking at an extraordinary man. We're not just looking at an extraordinary teacher who had a lot of good things to say. We're looking at God in the flesh, showing us this is what holiness is. This is what it looks like. All of those times you find God saying, "Be holy, for I am holy," you look at me, you look at God. Jesus is saying, "And I'll show you how to do it. And what a blessed thought that is, isn't it? What a blessed thought that is. In John 13 and verse 15, after having washed their feet, teaching them about service, Jesus said, "For I have given you an example that you should do just as I have done to you." I have given you an example, he said. It's not just instruction. I'm not just telling you to do things. I'm showing you those things. I'm showing you the heart that pleases God. Remember what Peter said? Talking about Jesus as well, 1 Peter 2 and verse 21, "For to this you have been called, because Christ suffered for you, leaving you an example, so that you might follow in his steps." One of the things, as I look back in my life, oh, there's so many wonderful Christians who have influenced me over the years. So many, more than I could ever say. And I have been blessed to have been able to sit at the feet of some of the most holy people I have ever known. Giants, spiritual giants. And listen to the sermons that they've preached and the classes that they've taught. But do you know what made an even bigger impact upon me, and what I remember even more than the words of those lessons? It's the examples that they set. It's the life that they lived. It's not just saying to me, "Be holy." It is saying, "Be holy, and this is how." And as wonderful as it's been to have so many Christians, so many in this very congregation who set those examples for us, beloved, our Lord did that. God, the Son, did that. I love Him for it. I hope that you do as well. I love Jesus because He showed us what compassion is. And He showed us what it's all about. I want you to consider two passages with me here, if you will. The first one has to do with a leper. Mark 1, verses 40 and 42. It says, "And a leper came to Him, imploring Him, and kneeling said to Him, 'If you will, you can make me clean.' Moved with pity, he stretched out his hand and touched him and said to him, 'I will be clean.' And immediately the leprosy left him, and he was made clean. On the other occasion, after a long day, and Jesus is tired, and the disciples are tired, and they need to take a rest. Over in 6 and verse 34, when he went ashore, he saw a great crowd, and he had compassion on them, because they were like a sheep without a shepherd, and he began to teach them many things." Now, I don't know about you, but one of the things that I find very helpful is kind of looking at the definition of a word and then kind of putting it, not changing it by any means, I mean, who has the right to change it, but kind of putting it in my own words. It sticks a little more when I do that. It sticks a little more in my mind. And watching Jesus Christ and the things that He does and how He behaves, this is what comes to me. I think Christ shows us that compassion is love and mercy combining. Combining to produce good for the individual. And that good can be physical or it can be spiritual. But love and mercy have combined. And when they do that, they must act. And I think Jesus, our Lord, shows us that. Now, there are a lot of passages that we could consider. Actually, Brother John, this morning in 1 John 3 and verse 16 showed us a passage. If we were to read on in the next couple of verses, we'll kind of go along with this thought. But the one that immediately comes to my mind, and I think to the mind of many Bible students, is Galatians 6 verses 9 and 10. "And let us not grow weary of doing good, for in due season we will reap if we do not give up. So then, as we have opportunity, Let us do good to everyone, and especially to those who are of the household of faith. Everybody in this world, everybody I've ever known, have had moments of compassion. I've known some really rotten people in my life. Really selfish, really mean-spirited. But I don't know anybody that I've had a continuing relationship with or acquaintance with that didn't have the occasional moment of compassion. But the example that Jesus shows us is not compassionate deed, selfish life, selfish life, selfish life, compassionate moment, selfishness, 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 compassionate moment. The example of Jesus is compassionate life. Always lived with other people in view. Not waiting for that opportunity to come up and smack them in the head, take them by the shoulder and say, look at me, here I am, looking for the opportunity, trying to help. And doing it because of love, because of mercy. Those things coming together in the example of Jesus, which we imbibe and then put in practice in our lives. Why have we been remade? Why have we been born again? For good works. Remember Ephesians 2 and verse 10? No, not good works to earn any sort of salvation. We can't do that. That ship sailed a long time ago. But we can show the world this is what one who loves Christ does. This is what one who trusts Christ does. And this is what one who is so filled with gratitude towards Christ does because he did. When we live compassionate lives, we show the character of Christ within our hearts. I love Jesus for showing me what compassion looks like and showing me what it's all about. I'll tell you something else. I love Jesus because of the incredible patience and long-suffering he showed in the midst of repeated spiritual failure. Now, we're not going to turn over to Matthew 20. We're actually going to turn to Luke 24. So if you want to go ahead and start turning over there, go ahead and do that. But in Matthew 20, in the verses that are listed here, just before this, our Lord had told his disciples again that he was about to die. And the time is short. He's almost there. And the very next thing we read is the mother of James and John coming up to Jesus with James and John in tow and asking for places of preeminence in his kingdom. And a few verses later, the other disciples find out and they're mad. They're angry at James and John for even doing that. And yet we remember why they had been doing it all along as well. I'll tell you what. You ever think Jesus was just sick and tired of it? You ever amazed that he didn't just throw up his hands and say, I'm done with you guys. I'm starting over with a new group of people. It's amazing to me. But after all of these events had occurred, the death has happened, the Lord has risen. I want you to look with me, if you will, picking up in verse 18. Now, two disciples are on the road to Emmaus. We know how that starts. Jesus has kind of come up upon them. What are you upset about? Why are you looking so sad? What are you talking about? And then one of them, named Cleopas, verse 18, answered him, are you the only visitor to Jerusalem who does not know the things that have happened here in these days? And he said to them, what things? And they said to him, concerning Jesus of Nazareth, a man who was a prophet, mighty indeed, in word before God and all the people, and how our chief priests and rulers delivered him up to be condemned to death and crucified him. But we had hoped that he was the one to redeem Israel. Yes, and besides all this, it is now the third day since these things happened. Moreover, some women of our company amazed us. They were at the tomb early in the morning, and when they did not find his body, they came back saying that they had even seen a vision of angels who said that he was alive. Some of those who were with us went to the tomb and found it just as the women had said, but him they did not see. Clearly, they're stating this as though anything could have happened except the resurrection. And he said to them, "Oh, foolish ones, and slow of heart to believe all that the prophets have spoken. Was it not necessary that the Christ should suffer these things and enter into his glory? And beginning with Moses and all the prophets, he interpreted to them in all the scriptures the things concerning himself." How many times did Jesus have to say to his disciples, "Oh, you of little faith, why did you doubt? Oh, foolish ones and slow of heart to believe all that has been written." And those are just the recorded times. And rather than throwing up his hands and saying, "I am done with you, I'm going on to someone else," he continued to show patience. He continued to work with them. And I love God for that. I love the Lord for it. One of the things that I think we have to bear in mind is that sin is always spiritual failure on our part. I think sometimes, even if it's an unintentional thing, we can kind of, in just the words that we use, lessen the significance of our own sins. Here's what I mean by that. And I look at my own life at times having done this. I did something. I transgressed. I stumbled. I violated the law, which is the definition of sin. And I said, "Well, you know, I just need to grow a little bit more." And that's true. Just need to grow a little bit more. Or, you know, it's just really a matter of maturity, and I'm going to mature a little bit more, and I'll get to the place where I can get over that and not do it again. And that may be absolutely true. In fact, it should be. Or I just hadn't studied that passage as thoroughly as I should have. I didn't really recognize it, and that may be true. I may have needed to do more study there and learn better what that passage means. But sin is always failure. Without exception. Always personal failure. How many times have you personally failed Jesus Christ in your life just as a Christian? How many times? Could you even count it? I couldn't. I want you to consider the grace that is willing to keep on forgiving. One of the great passages that just, I don't know how you can't fall more in love with Jesus upon reading this passage. 1 John 1 and verse 9 and chapter 2 and verse 1. "If we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us our sins and to cleanse us from all unrighteousness." You ever pause just there and say, why? Why should he keep doing that for me? He does. Chapter 2 and verse 1. "I am writing these things to you so that you may not sin." That's God's expectation for us, brethren. That's the Lord's expectation, that we don't sin. But if anyone does sin, we have an advocate with the Father, Jesus Christ the righteous. Show of hands, who deserves that grace? Who deserves that mercy? Who deserves that love? That patience, that long-suffering? Not a one of us. Not a one of us. And yet it's continually extended. Isn't that awesome? Isn't that awesome? And of course, it's that example, because sometimes, Sometimes, you know, I can look at that person who just keeps failing, particularly if they're failing in regard to their responsibilities to me. They're not doing right by me. And I can look at that person and I can say, why in the world should I forgive them? They mess up over and over and over again. Oh, and here comes the next apology. Here they come. Oh, I'm sorry. I'm going to do it again. And give it a couple of weeks, and I bet we're right back here. Why should I forgive that person? I think there's a really good reason, don't you? Beloved, don't burn the bridge. You've got to cross yourself. Don't burn the bridge you've got to cross. And that's exactly what can happen if we just decide we're not going to forgive. Jesus in the Great Sermon on the Mount, for if you forgive others their trespasses, your heavenly Father will also forgive you. And we could add to that, it's there by implication, over and over and over again. But if you do not forgive others their trespasses, neither will your heavenly Father or your Father forgive your trespasses. How many times have you had to go in prayer and just say, I'm sorry. I did it again. How many times? And yet He gives more grace. We serve an awesome God, don't we? Let's not forget it, and let's love our Lord for it. You know what else I love Jesus for? I love Him for the fact that He didn't show favoritism, but that He held everyone to the same standard. Now, we have that woman who was taken in adultery right there in John 8. And she's going to be a person of no social standing. Everybody's going to be looking down upon her. And in verse 11, Jesus said, neither do I condemn you. He was talking about condemning her to death. That's what they were going to do. And then He told her, go on and sin no more. But she's a person with no social standing. You can tell someone like that that they're guilty of sin and that they ought not to sin anymore. I mean, what's anybody going to say? Everyone's going to agree with her. So He held her to a standard. You stop sinning. But if we were to turn over, in fact, I'll ask you to do this, go over to John chapter 9, one chapter later, and we're going to find Jesus standing there around some of the spiritual leaders of that time, individuals who did wield influence and were looked up to. In verse 39, Jesus said, for judgment I came into this world, that those who do not see may see, and those who see may become blind. Some of the Pharisees near Him heard these things and said to Him, are we also blind? Jesus said to them, if you were blind, you would have no guilt. But now that you say we see, your guilt remains. He says the same thing, essentially, to that woman caught in adultery as He says to the Pharisees, the respected spiritual elite of the day, you're both guilty. You both need to stop sinning. There weren't two standards here. There was one. Now, what about when He comes across someone of a great deal of potential and perhaps a great deal of talent? What about that rich young ruler? We know the account. You can look at it there on your own time in Mark chapter 10, picking up in verse 17. It was a young man who had influence. It was a young man who had power. It was a young man who had wealth, who seemed to be doing a really good job as far as law keeping is concerned. This is who you want on your side. This is who you want to set forth to the world. Look who's come over to our side. But Jesus placed a massive stumbling block. In fact, it was a stumbling block that already existed. Jesus simply pointed it out. Yeah, you can come. In fact, I would love for you to. The passage says Jesus looked at him and loved him. But first, you go and sell all that you have. You give it to the poor. And then you come. There was something standing between that man and Jesus Christ, and the Lord wasn't going to ignore it. I could see how he might not ignore it to people who didn't have much as it relates to a great deal of influence and worldly means. And they're not the kind of people you're going to say, hey, look who I won, because people are going to say, well, big deal. They're fishermen. That's a tax collector. Who cares if they're on your side? But this is a young man of ability and wealth. And Jesus wasn't going to have him unless he took care of that pressing spiritual need. Favoritism is an ugly thing, isn't it? We've all seen it. It's a temptation for Christians too. You ever been in a position where, I guess you could say you were the victim of it? The victim of favoritism? That the other person is receiving what they're receiving, not because of any accomplishment or ability, just because they're the favorite for some reason. We see it around us all the time, don't we? All the time. It's an ugly thing. It's a temptation for Christians. You remember Galatians chapter 2? Paul had to confront Peter to his face. Peter had backed away from his Gentile brethren. He wasn't willing to eat with them anymore. He began to show favoritism towards his Jewish Christian brethren. You think the Gentile Christians there weren't discouraged by that? Didn't see it? Didn't notice it? Of course, there's the great example of James chapter 2, the man who walks in. But he's looking sharp. He's got a ring on. He's clean. He's just looking good. And then you have that shabby man who walks in, and you say to the rich man, hey, you get up there in that place of prominence. You shabby fella, get down there at my feet. Go sit over there somewhere. I want people to see you if you come in. Favoritism's an easy thing to fall into. Partiality, prejudice. Easy thing to fall into, but we never, ever see that from Jesus, do we? What our Lord shows us is that all souls are accountable to God. He never took a bribe. Never took a bribe. Never played favorites. And I'm glad, because there are a lot of things that people could bribe folks with that I don't have at my disposal. But our Lord never did that. He showed us a single standard, one that all are accountable for, and I love him for it. And there's one more point I want to bring out, and again, I'm going to say this is not a comprehensive list. There's no way it could be. I love Jesus for showing us what true faith and trust in God is capable of achieving. I want you to turn with me, if you will, over to John 18. We're going to read verses 1 through 9. John 18, beginning in 1. It says, when Jesus had spoken these words, he went out with his disciples across the Kidron Valley, where there was a garden, which he and his disciples entered. Now Judas, who betrayed him, also knew the place, for Jesus often met there with his disciples. Go ahead and pause. From John's gospel, we might conclude that nothing of any significance happened there in the garden. That they just happened to be going out there, just passing through, and we're going to go on from somewhere else. Well, John wrote his gospel last. Matthew, Mark, and Luke had already talked about what happened in the garden. When you take all of those things together, this is what we learn. Jesus said to them, my soul was sorrowful even unto death. He went away. We're told he fell on the ground. One gospel writer tells us he fell face first on the ground. And he began to plead with his Father, if it be possible, let this cup pass from me. He knew what was coming. And he did not relish the idea of having to experience it. His blood became like great sweat drops of blood. It was a time of such deep emotional anguish that God felt the need to send angels to him to minister to him. That's where Jesus was. That's what he was experiencing. But John doesn't show us that. He does show us something that the other gospel writers do not. Let's pick up in verse 3. So Judas, having procured a band of soldiers and some officers from the chief priests and the Pharisees, went there with lanterns and torches and weapons. Then Jesus, knowing all that would happen to him. Now listen to that, okay? Don't just gloss over that. Jesus, knowing all that would happen to them, came forward, stepped up to them. and said to them, "Whom do you seek?" They answered him, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus said to them, "I am he." Judas, who betrayed him, was standing with them. And when Jesus said to them, "I am he," they drew back and fell to the ground. So he asked them again, "Whom do you seek?" And they said, "Jesus of Nazareth." Jesus answered, "I told you that I am he. So if you seek me, let these men go." And this was to fulfill the word that he had spoken, "Of those whom you gave me, I have lost not one." Turn one chapter to chapter 19. All of the torture has occurred. Jesus is nailed to the cross at this point, and the end has come. Verse 28, "After this, Jesus, knowing that all was now finished, said, 'To fulfill the scripture, I thirst.' And a jar full of sour wine stood there. So they put a sponge full of the sour wine on a hyssop branch and held it to his mouth. And when Jesus had received the sour wine, he said, 'It is finished.' And he bowed his head and he gave up his spirit." And that is what faith and trust in God allows one to accomplish. Jesus went from a moment of extreme mental, emotional, and spiritual anguish in the garden. Jesus did not talk just to hear himself talk. And when he said, "I am in anguish, approaching or near to death," I think he meant exactly what he said. And yet when they came to arrest him, the moment had passed. And Jesus stepped up to them and said, "I am he." And he was in such control of himself and the situation that those men with the worst of intentions fell down before him. That's an extraordinary thought, isn't it? You ever have moments of self-doubt as it relates to your faith? I do. I do. You ever have times when you ask yourself, can I maintain? Can I hold fast? This, when that next trial comes, the one before, it hit me hard. When the next one comes, am I going to be able to stand through it and come out the other side with my faith intact? Am I going to be able to do that? Can I be bold and confident in the Lord? Can I be courageous? And at times we waver, and at times we doubt ourselves. And here's the thing, if it was all about ourselves and our own ability, there'd be every reason to doubt, wouldn't there? I can't do it by myself. And you can't either. But it can be done. Why? Because we're not doing this by ourselves. We're not doing it by ourselves. Paul, in 2 Corinthians chapter 1, makes a wonderful statement there. He says, "We do not want you to be ignorant, brothers, of the afflictions we experienced in Asia. For we were so utterly burdened beyond our strength." Now listen to that. Beyond our strength. There was nothing Paul or his companions could do to preserve their lives. They were burdened beyond their strength. "We despaired of life itself. Indeed, we felt that we had received the sentence of death." But notice, that was to make us rely not on ourselves, but on God who raises the dead. Do you remember Ephesians 6? Put on the whole armor of Adam. I've tried that armor and it's failed a lot of times. Put on the whole armor of God. Stand with His strength. And we can prevail. What an awesome thought. These are reasons, beloved, that I love God. I love Jesus. And of course, there are many more. Here's what I hope to take from this. If there are things you haven't thought about that we mentioned this morning, I'm glad. I hope that you begin to consider them. It's the habit that I hope you take away from this. See, there is no greater spiritual habit for us than counting the reasons, naming them for why we love our Lord. They are so many. It'll make us better. It'll make us stronger. I hope that as we get ready to start the new year, if this hasn't been a habit, it'll be one that you work on developing. Start it now. There may be some here this morning who are not Christians, and if that's the case, you have the opportunity now to become one. If you believe with all your heart that Jesus is the Christ, the Son of God, you've taken the first step. It's not the only one, though. Let that belief become Bible faith, and Bible faith involves obedience. Repent of your sins, confess your faith in Jesus as Lord, and be immersed in water, having your sins washed clean from your soul. All things are ready. The question is, are you? And if the answer is yes, please come forward now as together we stand and sing.